It's my honor to introduce our first keynote speaker, Danielle Merfeld of GE Renewable Energy. Thank you.
Thank you. Am I the only one who noticed that one of those words in the word cloud was CC? That's awesome. Thank you, by the way, to all the organizers for inviting me to be here today. It's a great opportunity for me to share some broad perspective on the really what you guys have chosen for this week, the decarbonizing the power system. That is the center of the bullseye for what we need to be focused on. So kudos to zeroing in on that. I'll just give you some bit of background. I've been with GE for over 20 years, and I've seen a lot of different transformations. GE, as a historic company, has been a part of a lot of transformations in the world, whether it was early grid development, power system centralization, whether it was modernizing the home, or aircraft propulsion, computers, or back in the very early days, medical imaging, and even lighting. So, and the lighting one, actually, that was my first role in GE, was to be a part of the transition from solids, from regular incandescent or halogen lighting to solid-state lighting. The difference for this transition, the energy transition, is big. There's probably three big things that make it different from every other transition that I've ever heard of or been a part of. One of them is the importance to everyone. There's not a person on the planet that won't get impacted if this is successful or if this is a failure. Even people who don't have energy are going to be impacted by this success or lack of. Second one is the urgency. As you heard Cece mention, and I'll give you a couple background views on why that urgency matters, this is unlike any other transition, which are usually driven by economics or social behaviors or technology. We can't afford to go at that pace. Just the economics, just the technology, just the social change won't be fast enough. So there's a lot of importance for policy and regulatory environments and changing how we do business. And I'll mention a little bit more about that. And then the third big thing that is a part of this transition that makes it different is the need to collaborate at a scale really that doesn't always jive with the way we work politically, economically, socially. No one company, I mean, GE has been a part of driving big campaigns of change, as many other companies or governments or individuals have been. No one group can do it alone. People are going to have to collaborate in ways we've never done before, and we're carving a new path every day. So the more people like you who come to try to learn and engage and collect partners and friends, this is what will make it successful. So thank you for being here, for paying attention to this, and to thinking about your role that you can play. And I hope you're thinking about the networks that you're building, because you need those to be successful. We all need those to be successful. So to double down a little bit on what you already heard, this also speaks to the urgency. Time matters a lot. Unfortunately, we've been burning fossils for too long. Even though we understood this trajectory, we are kind of at the stages where we've already baked in a lot of warming. In fact, people talk about 1.5 degrees Celsius. It's already warmed more than 4 in the Arctic. So the poles are warming much faster than the rest of the Earth. You can talk about average temperatures every day of the week, but this is all nonlinear systems. The best of our models are 50% knowledge. We are almost only going to see downside to all of those models. So take everything with a grain of salt on the downside, that we don't have as much time as we think, that we're not going to hit the temperatures that we think. And the reason why the energy sector is so important here is because 75% of those emissions come from the energy sector. So we're not just an important part of managing climate change. We are the main event. Energy sector doesn't get converted and we don't see the transformation, nothing else matters. So I'm going to walk you through two pages, because we heard the International Energy Agency and people talk about scenarios all the time. So I wanted to just spend a little bit of background to make sure we are all on the same page with this. So, and actually just a couple weeks ago, the International Energy Agency came out with their 2022 forecasts or scenarios. These were from last year, but they're not that different. And they show, and there's other groups that do this too. This is just one of the ones that gets quoted often. They're not so dissimilar from each other. But these four scenarios systematically get mistaken for forecasts. They're not forecasts, they're scenarios. So each one is based on a set of assumptions. The first one, stated policies, or STEPs for short, that's the path we're on now. That's the policies that we have employed around the world. And if we continue on that, I'm just going to go forward a little bit, that's our blue trajectory of global median temperature rise. We're going to be, by the end of the century, over 2.5 degrees and growing. And a lot of that we can't stop even if we decarbonize then. Sorry, let me go back. So the next one is announced pledges. So that's the best we've said. Everybody's promised globally. And after COP26 last fall, that actually went down. So we actually got better. Everyone promised more. And that correlates, I'll show you in a minute, to a lower temperature. But it's still too high, still over 2 degrees. And now the next two scenarios. So these first two scenarios the IEA made, not for any purpose of outcome, just to show us the gap between what we say we want to do and what we're actually doing. And by the way, neither one is good enough. So the next two scenarios are driven by outcomes. The first one, sustainable development, is aligned to meeting the Paris Agreement. So no more than 1.5 degrees of warming by the end of the century. The second one, net zero, gets you to no more than 1.5 degrees at all. You don't overshoot it and come back. You just kind of peak at that by 2050. So this is how it looks with all four in terms of temperature rise. Clearly, we need to be in the green zone between the sustainable development and the net zero emissions. That's kind of the sweet spot for everything we're trying to do as a community in terms of reducing emissions in the energy sector especially. What does that look like in the power sector? So on the left-hand side, this is still all energy. Nothing on here is power yet. But you can see the power emissions by that sector is a big chunk of all of the energy emissions. But as you heard already, and I know you know this well, it's a two-punch opportunity, right? You have to clean up the power sector and electrify everything. Because the more you electrify, the more transport, industry, buildings use electricity. And at the same time, you're in parallel cleaning up the power system, then it becomes clean electricity. And you've sort of electrified and cleaned up your electricity. So again, today, if you look on the left or the right-hand side, the bar charts, 20% of our energy is no emissions. 20% of our primary energy globally is zero emissions. Now, also about 20% of our electricity is zero emissions, but those just are, it just happens to be that way. They're not really related. So if 20% of our primary energy is carbon-free, the rest of it is carbon-emitting. Forecasts for any of this green zone mean most people are saying you need at least 60 to 70% of that carbon-emitting power to become clean electrification. So clean electrification, clean power systems, green is the biggest part of what's going to convert the energy supply. So there's a lot of discussion about the hard to abate sectors. Hydrogen is a super sexy topic, and I could happy to answer a lot of questions on that in the Slido portion of the discussion today. But there's a reason why this focus is on decarbonizing the power sector and why I really want to leave you with the passion for that being the main event. Because yes, we need hydrogen. Yes, we need these hard to abate sectors, industry, shipping, all that stuff. But that's not going to happen until the 2030s. And if we don't get this decade right, it'll all be too late. I mean, it's all going to be necessary, but we've got to focus on timing. Because let me just go back one more minute. On this, if you look where we are now, we're just a little bit past that green, where the green starts. Look out to 2032-ish. So that's this next decade. If we do it right, we're going to be cutting emissions from this perspective. If we don't decarbonize the power sector this decade, because that's really the technology that's ready. We already have wind and solar. We have a lot of capability. But if we don't deploy it, that means we're going to have a little bit more of a plateau and then a drop. It's the area under the curve that matters. So it means you have to have almost an unimaginable steep drop later. So this is all about managing our time. And so I wanted to talk about the power mix. And this aligns with the top of the green part, the sustainable development scenario that IEA puts out. If we follow that path, what does that look like for the power mix globally? This is not for any one country, and clearly it's different depending on where you are in the world. But generally on average, you're going to see a pretty significant growth in wind and solar. So by 2030, you have about more than 25% more total electricity, and a lot of that growth comes from variable renewable energy, wind and solar. And by 2050, there's more just wind and solar than all of our electricity system globally in 2020 and 2030. So you've added more wind and solar in that last 20 years than it took us last 120 years to build up until 2030. That's significant growth. This is also a generation view. For those of you who understand the dynamics of producing wind and solar power, the capacity factor is relatively low compared to more conventional systems. So the capacity that you have to install is quite a bit larger. So if this was showing capacity instead of generation, you'd have to grow by over 40% in the next 10 years and triple the total amount of electricity needed by 2050, of capacity needed. So this is only roughly doubling. Now, this is also the sustainable development scenario. Remember the net zero energy scenario, which doesn't have any kind of assumptions about negative emissions technology being deployed in the last half of the century, which many people feel is a much more pragmatic view, especially considering both those scenarios are 50% probability. So any downside, you've kind of lost the race. That view, the net zero energy, you'll probably see, I think it's closer to 8 times more electricity, and a lot of that is wind and solar. So there's two things about this transition. One is very obvious and one is not very obvious. And I found this to be the case with almost every transition. So the really obvious one is, that's a lot of wind and solar. Can we do that? Does that work? Like, are we physically able to make that many wind turbines and that many solar panels? And even if it's going to be expensive, can we even do it? And by the way, it's not expensive. So that's the good news, is we've already sort of had the cost curve prove out. Solar and wind isn't cheaper than anything else on the planet. But this is why I don't think we need to worry about it. The next two charts kind of just show. People that worry about whether we can do it, it's reasonable and we're human and we have a linear brains and that's how we evolved, but this is not a linear thing. We've seen it now for 20 years. And even the IEA, who are experts in energy, every year they put out a forecast for what they think is gonna happen in the sector. So this was their solar forecast for the last 20 years or so. And every year they say, wow, this was a great year for solar. Going forward, it's gonna be more flat. Like, we've hit the limit on that access for that material. Or now it's gonna be priced out because gas just got cheaper in the mid 2010s, you know. Every year they found a really logical reason. I was working in solar back in 2007, 2008, and I was on board. Yeah, it's a great run. We're almost there, but it's probably gonna flatten out. Every year, they were surprised. And in fact, this last year, you would think after almost 20 years of consistent exponential growth, somebody would say, I don't know how they're gonna do it, but they're probably gonna pull it out one more year. Even this last year, they're 21, I guess I'll go back to what you can see on the page here. The 2020 forecast was beat in 21 by almost 15 years. So they were wrong. 1 year off, what they thought would take 15 years took one. So for us to not expect that this is gonna continue, that there's gonna be like a Moore's Law kind of continuation of this, is a little bit impractical at this point. It goes the other way too. This is specifically for the United States, and it was the EIA, who are the US Energy Experts, Energy Information Act. They're the ones who said every year coal will come back. You know, gas is gonna get expensive or renewables are too pricey. And every year we started using less and less coal. A lot of this was driven by cheap gas in the US. But still, industry experts didn't see exponential change happening. So I hope that these kind of give you a sense that the more obvious challenge of can we do it with the wind and solar volume, still a challenge. We're doing a lot of work in GE to get there too, but that's not the biggest part of the challenge. That the secret part of the challenge is maybe harder. So I think the part that I'll leave you with, this last bit I'll wrap up here, is the grid is really where the secret part of the problem is. And I just to give you a little bit more of an explanation for that, when I got into GE, I was there working on LEDs, and we thought we were gonna try to make solid state lighting cheap enough, good quality of color, good value return. And what we missed was the way people buy light bulbs doesn't care about value return. We really had to rethink who's buying light bulbs and why. And instead of going to homes first, even though it was a great payback, a 10-year life, you know, over that lifespan, nobody goes to the grocery store and decides they're gonna do a cost trade-off for a 10-year life light bulb. We needed to start going to different people like that ran factories that, you know, the CFOs were the ones who invested in lighting first. So the secret issue with the growth of renewables on the grid is, how does the grid handle that? And the grid was not designed for the way that it will have to work in the future and fast. And the grid doesn't change very fast, as many of you know. It's regulated, there's codes and standards, all for good reasons, and the way our systems work take time. So let me just walk you through what's different. Many of this is all pictured here and you probably know a lot of it, but I wanna give you a little bit more of a fine point, because there's actually three fundamental transformations of the grid that have to happen fast. The first one is the physics of the grid is gonna change. So think about the way most of the generators that are connected to the grid are synchronous generators. That's great. Gas turbines, steam turbines, a lot of spinning hot things, right? And the spinning inertia is really helpful because that spinning, by the way, is a rotational frequency that gives us 60 hertz or 50 hertz in some places. And if something, some disturbance happens on the grid, that inertia is there to kind of dampen it. So you got like shock absorbers built in. They're your generators and your shock absorbers, two for the price of one. Now, power electronics are how wind and solar connect to the grid. Now, you program power electronics, and they're very fast, which today, if you're not using them right or if you're not balancing your system right, they can go wildly out of whack and screw up your grid. They don't respond to grid disturbances the same way. But I would argue they're power electronics. I mean, they're highly programmable. They're highly manageable. You could actually design in, if you were designing your system to use power electronics, I would argue you could make it even more resilient, even more sustainable, even more capable than what you have today, even though it's a very elegant, simple design. GE was a part of setting up how the grid would work using synchronous generation. So that's the one thing, is the physics are changing, and the grid's codes and standards for how the grid operates don't change fast. So now utilities, system operators, OEMs, we all have to work together to figure out how do we form the grid, how do you set voltage and frequency with power electronics, are you going to do that the same everywhere? There's a whole bunch of working groups trying to collaborate today across lines that we never used to cross before. We would never make something unless the system operator told the utility to do it and the utility told us they would buy it. Then we would develop it, then they would, that's too long. We all have to jump expecting we're going to land in a safe place. And it's scary, especially when you work for a company that wants to make money. So everybody has to sort of be on board with this. The next big transformation is operational. So the way the grid operates today is based on having pretty constant fuel that's very controllable, piles of coal, pipelines of gas. We're moving to, like, nature tells us when we're going to get fuel. Now, it's one thing I really want to be careful about is you probably hear people say intermittent a lot. I would propose everyone in this room take that out of your vocabulary and put in variable. It's a much more accurate way to describe renewables. Intermittent sometimes makes you think it's surprising. It is highly predictable. Highly predictable, and we can use that to help manage the grid. It's just not controllable, and that's a big change in how we operate now. The other big operational change is the fact that a lot of the renewables plants are much smaller, and they're more disparate. Like, they're spread all around. You don't have these huge gigawatt-scale plants. You've got a bunch of hundreds of megawatt plants. That means you don't have a big generator and then a big load center and one-way transmission flow. Transmission's going to flow different ways depending on where the sun is, where the wind is blowing, how much load do you need. So our systems have to operate differently. We have to be able to manage a bunch of different sites instead of a few big ones. So this is going to be another big part of the operational change. And then lastly, from an operational change, I'll go to the far right side, demand. Demand has been pretty constant, in this country especially, for decades. That's all changing. As you electrify more, your demand grows. And you're going to have weird demand, like huge charging for cars, right, for EVs, and they're going to move around, and they're going to discharge over here and then charge over here, and they get to decide what time. We have to figure out the operational rules to make this all work well, because if you think about it, you actually need a lot less overall system. You need less storage. You need less renewables when everything works together and when you can manage your demand, and you have more transmission to spread things out farther. So there's a lot of planning that can go into making a smart system that you don't overspend for any of these pieces. The last transformation, I would say, is the markets. It's all the economics around this. And value is completely different. I mean, fuel, it was worth going to war for. And we're seeing the effects of that still. Energy security is national security now. So you're going from fuel that was worth going to war for to literally free. The democratizing nature of that is awesome. And it totally screws up the markets. And the markets today are all based on energy, mostly. And energy is great, but energy is like you open a spigot and it just flows. Are you paying for it to flow, or are you paying for it to turn on and off when you want? Do you want flexibility? Do you need capacity? If we don't reward generators for flexibility or capacity or any of the other ancillary services that the grid needs to be resilient, you won't get them. So markets all around the world, the UK is doing great. Australia has been going through a lot of ups and downs and have been thinking about how to fix their markets. The US is just right around the corner. We're going to have to pay for energy differently, or pay for things besides energy. So these three transformations that the grid have to go through, and the collaborations and the partnerships that are going to be required to make it all work smoothly, are unprecedented. And you have to do it fast. because this isn't going to be like by 2030, we need to be there. No, by 2030, we need to put more solar and wind on our grids globally than we ever could imagine putting on today. So this is the secret part of the transition that's super hard, and it complements the visible part, which many of us understand well. But when you talk about decarbonizing the power system, this is the bigger challenge, I think. But it's also going to be, maybe my last point here is, like any really great big event, the people who make this work are also going to be the unsung heroes, because they're like nerdy power systems engineers sitting in a control room or working in utilities. They're not going to get, you know, songs written about them. They're not going to get highly paid, but they're going to work like crazy to make this work. And I think that's something that I want everybody to appreciate, because I'm building a huge appreciation for the people behind the scenes that are working on these transformations. And if I could leave you with anything, you know, when they save the world, everybody will yawn and expect that it was going to happen anyway. And we just, it's good that we know. All right, let's move to Slido then. Thank you.
Danielle, this question here that's really resonating with the audience really ties into one of your last points, which is, what do you think is the biggest challenge for turning recent US energy policy into energy transition results?
Yeah, I would say the biggest challenge I would have said this summer was demand consistency and really demand outlook, because most of the, I was speaking from a wind OEM position, this country in the US has been terrible for wind policy. It's been really great, and then it's been really bad over and over and over again for a decade and a half, which meant we'd build up a supply chain, we'd kill the supply chain. We'd build it up and kill it. And now we're experiencing a lot of quality issues, cost constraints. Around the world, it's a different challenge, but that would have been what I said in the US this summer. Clearly, Inflation Reduction Act changed that. We now have a 10-year run of demand expectations that we can bank on, that we can build supply chains and build out capability. Around the world, it's not like that, though. In fact, us having such a rich policy, especially in hydrogen, is kind of screwing up European policy right now, because they have to consider how do they attract investment and how do they make it work. They're doing things less, like I would say we're incentivizing the product. Germany, for example, is incentivizing the markets. So they're helping trade rather than helping make something cheaper. The biggest challenge, I would say, now is having all of the policy, regulatory and market changes happen in a cohesive way so that there's not, I mean, so that there's not big disconnects. The good news about this grid challenge that I posed at the end is that there's six system operators around the world. And Audrey, who you'll hear from later today, was one of the key founders of this six consortia when she was in Australia. They're working together and they've banded together. This is Australia, National Grid in the UK, Ireland, ERCOT, California, and Denmark. And they've said, look, we have really big problems on our grid. We're gonna see them first. The rest of the world is gonna get to them. I might see something different from UC, but we're all gonna get it in the end. You know, water is rising, we're all gonna be underwater, so let's just figure this out. And they're collaborating today on challenges that they can all see coming, and each one of them is doing experiments in their own systems, and they're working with utilities, and they're working with OEMs, and technical people in universities to solve those problems, and then they're sharing them broadly. So that helps them, because anything that works here should work everywhere. And if everything gets to be adopted the same, we've got standards, we've got companies that are investing in products, like that is the solution, but it's still untested. It's the biggest challenge, and I feel like we've got good traction, but the proof is in the pudding. We'll see if that plays out, as I hope it will.
Given the need to build out massive amounts of new electrical generation and distribution, how do we successfully manage the land use impacts and NIMBYism?
Yeah, so land use is a big topic. It'll be interesting to see how public discourse evolves, because it started a pretty primary school kind of view of land, meaning if there was a wind farm there, you were using all that. Now, clearly, there's a lot of dual use for land, especially around wind farms. Similarly, solar can do that. I think the first and foremost thing that the renewable energy industries need to do is be very clear about the best case. Like, we don't need to go into habitats that are sensitive when there's a lot of other options. So the good part about the first half of this decade is we don't really need to make a big stink about this, because there's a lot of land that is really good for renewables that doesn't have as many issues. Now, there's always going to be somebody who doesn't want to see that near them. Part of our challenge with land use is not a land use problem, it's a public engagement problem. We don't have enough investment in educating and listening and partnering. When a community knows that they're going to have not just contributing to the welfare of the society, but when they know they're going to get money, when they're going to get benefit for their community, and they can see that and feel that, we know it works. We've seen communities change their mind going from NIMBY to YIMBY when there's money involved or when there's economic opportunities for their children involved. So I think there's a lot of discourse that needs to happen that doesn't always happen yet, and that's way more important than land use, which we have a lot of land use issues that are invisible today in our current fossil fuel-based energy enterprise. Rather than us kind of pointing and saying, well, they do this and we do that, it's just about let's just get people to talk.
Danielle, if you were restarting your career, would you work in innovation, for example, carbon capture, utilization and storage, or hydrogen, et cetera? Or execution, wind, solar storage, what is most needed?
That's a good question. I think if I were to just put my innovation hat on, it's very, very typical, and I've been in technology for 25 years, to say I want to work on the thing that's the biggest, farther out, give me time to really sink my teeth in. So it kind of would lean towards the hydrogen carbon capture. However, what I've learned in the position I'm in now is that there is a ton of innovation in deployment and in execution. Like, I used to think that that was kind of like for the engineers, and I was a scientist slash engineer. Like, it is all about doing things in a different way and being innovative. I've never been more engaged in innovation than when it's almost real, like when it's actually real. We're trying to, like right now, we're not just worrying about how to make more wind turbines. We're completely rethinking how to build blades and towers. Like, it's a whole blooming opportunity. So I still, especially because it aligns with my panic about we don't have much time and the next decade counts, I don't want to sit in the back seat and work on the next decade problems. I would definitely choose the latter and work on execution.
Looking forward, what does next generation nuclear power plants fit into the transition?
So just like hydrogen, which is going to be an important part of decarbonizing our hard to decarbonize industrial sectors, nuclear is going to be an important part of giving us firm, clean power. Not everything is going to be renewable based on variable energy. For those gas plants that survive, they're going to run on hydrogen or they're going to be carbon capture. There's going to be a need for that base load, and nuclear, especially small modular nuclear, other innovations in nuclear is going to absolutely be a part of that solution. It's, again, we're going to start realizing things like small modular at the end of this decade, and then they'll start to grow and become contributors in the 2030s, 2040s. It's exciting, but it's also not the main event today. But we still need people doing that. GE has plenty of activities there. I worry that they think I'm disparaging them. I'm just trying to make sure everyone knows the chapters and which chapter we're in now.
What are your thoughts on mining of minerals like cobalt, nickel, lithium for the use of EVs? Is it sustainable?
Yes, so that's a great question. I'm glad that that was voted up, because one of the things I think, and this was sort of like the question about does wind turbines kill too many birds? Like, a lot of this is just based on great questions, and we as an industry maybe aren't answering those questions very well. So let me try to give you my perspective on it. Taking things out of the ground and using them is something we do a lot of today. The amount of metals and minerals we're gonna need for the next, till 2050, is about the volume in tons that we take out of the ground every 6 weeks today for fossil fuels. Now, I could argue on the other side, oh, but those are from deep underground and you bring them out and you know you don't see the open pit mine. Well, you'd feel it in the atmosphere, but it's a different kind of thing. But the better argument, so I could argue that we don't use as many minerals as you think we do compared to the stuff we use today. But the better argument is, when you burn a fossil fuel molecule, you use it once and it's gone. For all of these minerals, cobalt, lithium, everything, you don't consume it ever. It goes into a product, the product has a lifetime, and it's all still there. The battery might not charge as well, the lithium is still there. So the big challenge for materials use, one is more sustainable mining practices, and we're working with some mines to make some great zero waste, all renewable based mines. But the more important challenge is when the volume is big and the market is there and the economics support it, this has to be a circular economy. This has to be recycling every molecule, every atom of those metals and materials that are out there, and there will be a huge economy behind that because it's going to get more expensive to mine them as you have to go into more places and dig deeper. So you're going to start having this system where you take it out of reuse and bring it back through the cycle. That's something that I didn't really think about, that it's all still there. So just using it effectively, not just over the lifetime of the product, but over the life cycle of the industry is going to be our challenge.
I think we have time for one more question. We have a couple minutes left. This is more focused on GE. So how much technology risk is GE taking on next generation wind, solar, and storage? How do you decide where, when to take a long shot?
That's a good question. I will say that the biggest risk that a company like GE has is not in any of those products. So making the next generation of wind or storage or solar, we are partnered with industry, we're working with academics, we're not scaling things, which is the expensive part, until we know it works, until we've vetted it in the lab and in a prototype. So those are relatively constrained risks. The bigger risks for a company like GE, and I'll use our portfolio as the example, but other companies have different portfolios and different examples. I say our biggest risk is projects, so offshore wind projects. It's not just about does the wind turbine work, but can you effectively service it? Are your operating expenses what you put in the system, you know, what you put in your pro forma? What if a blade breaks? How do you fix it? Like, it's a lot of new challenges and operational challenges that you just don't see as much until you're in it. Another project that's not offshore is HVDC. So these are billions of dollars of investment into a project that we might own. In fact, we might do the offshore wind farm and the HVDC or AC system to shore. That's tens of billions of dollars of risk on our balance sheet. So I think every big company that's making these big systems from a projects perspective is going to have to think about how to balance that risk, how to share it with investors or with partners or with the EPC that's engaged. We're not at the stage yet where these big companies like GE have sorted out how they're going to manage it, but GE's in a turning point. We're going to be spinning off our energy businesses into a separate company, a separate standalone public company in probably the first quarter of 24. Without all the rest of the GE balance sheet behind us, this will become even more critical for us to figure out how to balance that risk. What can we do? What partners and what offtake of that risk do we need to have to even be confident enough to bid and win and execute on these big projects? So thank you very much. I appreciate it.